Border Patrol and ICE, and indeed the American people, are facing a real crisis on the border. And we're going to be talking about that and airing some of the interviews that we got today on the Hot Zone. So stay tuned.
This is the Hot Zone. Engaging with the news in a whole new way, international war correspondent Chuck Holton brings insight into areas of crisis and lets you help those affected.
This is the bollard-style fencing that the Trump administration says it would like to build along the entire southern border, and it's very effective. It's 18 feet high, it's got a no-climb element on top of smooth metal, and it's filled with concrete, so it's really hard to cut down like we've seen them do elsewhere. And the problem with that is, right now there are so many people coming across the border that all of the agents are off the border processing people, and they can't be here watching this fence. So no fence is going to be effective if you can't watch it, but especially if the fence just ends like it does right here, and there you have Mexico. So what we're seeing is migrants just walking right across. They go around the fences being built. And so there's a group of American volunteers that has decided to try to assist the Border Patrol and do something about that. So I'm here with Jim Benvie. They're with the United Constitutional Patriots. And it's a patriotic group that is out here trying to help along the border. Tell me a little bit about what you all are doing out here.
Well, the biggest thing we're doing out here is we're assisting in delivering a message to the United States that there is, in fact, a crisis and a national emergency on our U.S. border. The way that we're doing this is we have a group of ex-military and ex-law enforcement that have all basically given up their time to come down here and assist an overstrained Border Patrol. In the process of assisting them, we are documenting the people that are coming in, as well as putting out videos that probably will never be seen on any other news network.
Yeah, I haven't seen any on the news. And so we're going to put some of those in this podcast.
Absolutely.
And tell me what the motivation is for the people who are coming and sitting out here in the hot sun and, you know, doing this day after day.
It's a crisis. What we have is quite a few crises, actually. One of them is we have people coming from all over the world, coming through our border by the thousands on a daily basis. And some of them are using asylum claims, which are fraudulent. Some of them are using children. For those of you that don't know, children is one of the biggest things that kind of should concern everybody involved in this picture. What happens is that they've monetized children. If you come across the U.S. border and you've got a child, that is pretty much a ticket for you to stay here. So what's happened as a result of that is we have children that don't belong to individuals being used to come through the border. We have a term called child recycling. Child recycling is when one parent comes with the child, comes in, and then sends the child back to the other person they're trying to get in, uses the same child. And then, of course, we have the kidnapped babies that come in, don't belong to the parent, and then when they get in, they have no use for the baby, so they sell them into sex trafficking.
Now, I've got unsubstantiated reports of this happening here, but I have actually seen it happening in on the border of Venezuela, where I just was. But I've been told that it also happens here, although I can't corroborate that, that people will rent their babies to
yes,
people
absolutely,
coming across.
Absolutely.
And once you get across, get processed and everything, then you send it back. And, you know, you people are actually making money off of their children that way. But again, I don't have independent corroboration of that happening right here, although I have seen it happen in Venezuela.
It is happening here. We've got videos where you can clearly tell that the man with the child it's not his kid.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing is, and this is where the real national emergency is. Even if you're somebody who's just saying, well, these poor people, they're just coming here for a better life, consider this. When you have a group of 1,000 people come across the border illegally and they all just say, hey, we're here to claim asylum, they tie up the Border Patrol agents that are on duty. The cartel knows this. And so the cartel uses them as a distraction so that they can get the more dangerous people across the border through other routes. They're able to traffic more drugs.
Mm-hmm.
They're able to human traffic, sex traffic, opioids, whatever, you name it. And so while everybody is concerned about this, them being compassionate, The real criminals, the people that know they won't make it through that process that we talk about, where they get the criminal background check, the ties to terrorism check. Mm-hmm. There's not a lot of documentation that's done on the children either, just so you guys know, are aware of that, okay? So don't think that just because we process them or they get sent to processing that, oh, we're going to immediately identify that this isn't somebody's kid. That's not what's happening.
Yeah, I think a lot of people think that these kids come across and we're checking their passports. These kids don't have passports. A lot of the adults don't have passports.
That's correct.
These are stateless persons. They have no paperwork. They appear in no database anywhere. They've never been fingerprinted. They've never had their biometrics taken. And so there really is nothing to check. And so this person could say, I'm from Guatemala, when they're actually from El Salvador. They could say, I'm from Nicaragua, when in reality they're from Syria, for Pete's sake. I mean, I've reported on people who have been mistaken for people of other nationalities over the last several years. So that definitely does happen. Now, tell me about this place where we are right here. What's going on right here behind you?
Right behind us, we're in a what they call, this is Sunland Park. This is part of the New Mexico El Paso border. This right here is a Napa, Mexico. This wall you see right here, right down there is where this wall ends, okay? And if you can see my hand, which you can't, yes, but up behind us there's a mountain. That's all open, it's all Mexico. And so we're here in this area because this is an area where they can cross. They cross during the day, they cross at night. The runners a lot of times will go up in these hills behind us. Sometimes there's tunnels down here by the railroad tracks where they can get out into the middle of this field here. Literally, they're coming in from everywhere, guys. That's the message that we're trying to portray.
This now, are you seeing them yourself?
Oh, we're not only seeing them, but if you guys get to those videos, you're going to see probably a lot more than you want to see. We've had people, literally women and children, come into walking into Camp Liberty, that's the name of our camp, and we get them over there and they collapse. I mean, there was a one we've got documented on video. Had we not been there, she probably would be dead. So it's not a racism thing. It's about coming here legally. Yes, I know we need more attorneys, and I know that it's not just an issue of a wall. That's just one step. You know, we have to have reform in our immigration laws. But you can't just tell everybody in the world that they can just come here, say the word asylum, and then let them go into the community. We can't sustain this. The healthcare can't sustain it. The Border Patrol can't sustain it. The detention facilities here can't sustain it. They're now, I believe, calling for help for people to house these people. If you've been to any of the hotels around here in El Paso, you're not going to get a room. They're full of illegal immigrants. It's like little caravans at the hotels. And from what I understand, we're expecting over 1,000 a day just in this sector. This is a 2,200-mile border.
In the last 2 days, what the Border Patrol commissioner just told us, in the last 2 days, they have received
right
more than 4,000 a day. For the
yes
last 2 days.
Running. Just in this sector.
Yeah, just in El Paso
yes
sector. Yep. And so that is so far above crisis levels, it's just not even funny. It's like saying if the river gets to 10 feet, it's at flood stage, and today it's at 110 feet.
You right. Know, I mean, the numbers from the Border Patrol, if you want some specific numbers, this month, or February, we'll use February because that was the documented month. Last year in February, the number of families coming in claiming asylum versus this February claiming asylum is up 1,636% in this sector. And I know Arizona's having issues. I know California's having issues. And Oath Keepers are over in Texas. They're having issues over on the Rio Grande.
That's and, right. And so let's talk about your organization. I mean, there are a lot of disparate groups that are trying to help, that are
correct
volunteers like yours. Some of them are what you would call militias. They're out
correct
there, you
yep
know, they're carrying guns around and they're patrolling yep the border and that sort of thing. Yep. I don't see firearms. Tell me about your organization.
Well, we do carry firearms. We carry them for our protection only. Mm-hmm. People ask us all the time, what is the rule of engagement? It's no different than if we were on the street. Unless we're shot at or somebody feels there's an imminent threat of death, mm-hmm, we're not here to shoot people. But we do have dangerous people around us. We do have serious criminals, cartels that don't care. Mm-hmm. And again, you're dealing with big numbers. You know, to assume that every time 200 people come through the border, that every single one of them is a good citizen is absolutely insane.
Well, we know that's not
so
the case.
That's not
I've
the case.
Traveled
yeah, right,
them,
right,
and
right.
I can tell you that I speak Spanish, and so you talk to them. The only question you have to ask is, have you been to the United States before? And they'll say, well, yeah, I've been there 3 or 4 times. And you say, well, why aren't you there now? And they say, because I was deported. So if that's the
right.
case, then ipso facto, they are a criminal
yes,
coming into the United States.
That's exactly right.
Most of them have been deported for criminal acts, not just the act of coming into the United States illegally.
That's right.
So I've seen that with my own eyes as well. But answer the people who say, well, you guys shouldn't be out here. You know, this is you're vigilantes. You're not being helpful at all. This is vigilantism. This is being a militia. Mm-hmm. A bunch of right-wing whack jobs, you know, that kind of thing.
Right, right.
How do you answer those kind of accusations?
Well, you know, our group also has done a lot of work during the hurricanes. And we do carry arms. We're first responders in a hurricane. And we work aside law enforcement during a hurricane. This is a national emergency. This isn't a joke. This isn't even a political stunt. This is not manufactured. We're down here. We have very highly trained individuals down here. Some that have, and I hate to say this, no disrespect, but more training than the Border Patrol. So it's a very disciplined organization. For you people that don't think that we should be here, the only thing I can say to you is that you're not on the border. You're not seeing what's going on. Maybe your eyes aren't open. Maybe you believe Nancy Pelosi and her narrative that nothing's wrong down here. Our only goal down here is to send the American people a message and to show them boots on the ground. We do not think that we can stop in this little sector everything that's going on the border without a border wall, without border security. That's why we're behind Trump. He's giving it to the American people the way it is. And I don't know if it's just because they hate the man, what it is, but he's telling the truth. And so we're trying to document that truth from a non-biased, very neutral position of live feed video to show what's mm-hmm. exactly going on.
Yeah, and live feed video, at least you're not editing it.
There's no editing.
Yeah, you're just showing what you're seeing.
We're showing what we're seeing.
Yeah, that makes sense. And right, left, or center, it's a humanitarian crisis for the people coming across, if nothing else.
Absolutely. What about the kids? I had a guy did a debate on ABC7, and the guy asked me, or the guy was talking about, you know, oh, you're just not being humanitarian. Well, let me ask you a question. What about these kids? You wouldn't answer my question. Mm. Okay, these kids, every group we see that comes in, 40 to 50% of them are made up of children. Some of them unaccompanied. Some of them are babies with phone numbers on them. Mm. Okay? These kids are being used. As long as our immigration system stays the way it is right now, we have monetized children. What I'd like to see happen is, why don't they go down to these southern countries and find out how many kids are missing, have been reported kidnapped, mm-hmm. okay? And put that database together and compare it against the database we have here. But unfortunately, again, guys, we don't have a database here.
And they don't keep databases like that.
No, they don't. And then we got children that come unaccompanied. Well, they're being housed in government daycare centers, mm-hmm. and they could end up staying there till they're 18 years old, and then they get what's called assimilation citizenship. But then 18 years raised in a government daycare center. Yeah. Is that good for people either?
That's not healthy.
The drugs coming in, it's a crisis.
So are you seeing drugs, or I mean, are they?
Absolutely we are.
Yeah.
Yes, we are. Matter of fact, they do all kinds of things to bring them in. We'll have, you know, there's only so much we can do. We can't break the law as citizens. We can, as they say, observe and report.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. See something, say something. Okay, I can't stop a vehicle in here, even if I know it has drugs in it. The Border Patrol can stop it, but even they're limited. They can ask, are you a U.S. citizen? Do you have any illegals? They may take it a step further and say, can I open the trunk of your car? Or can I search your vehicle?
Mm-hmm.
If the person denies that, you know, then maybe they can bring out a dog. The dog hits, then they can open the door. But they do all kinds of things here.
Please come more close.
They literally, you know, they'll come through the border here on a motorcycle, drive up to the hill over here, and switch drivers, and come back down this way. And we see it. We see people on the train, the railroad track behind me here, people hiding on the train. Those aren't people that are coming here to claim asylum. Those are criminals.
Mm.
We see the coyotes leading groups of people. Sometimes we have chases out here at night. There's not enough Border Patrol available most of the time to deal with that. Wow. And if you could talk to a Border Patrol agent off the record, here's what they would say to you. I didn't join the Border Patrol to be an Uber driver. They're not out here fighting crime right now. Okay, they were pulled off the highways, the checkpoints. There's no more checkpoints. They're all down here to deal with the asylum seekers. Mm-hmm. So the cartel over there is getting rich, anywhere from 1,700 to I think it's 5,000 a head to get them up here, and they don't even have to bring them into the U.S. They drop them off at the border. They use the Border Patrol as an Uber service. The cartel, Mexico, is getting rich. And then at the same time, you've got the cartel moving drugs like it's candy. So when they say there's no crisis, I can tell you this. If the number of people coming in is up 1,636%, the amount of drugs and crime coming into the country is equal to that, because we're not catching them. Here, one last thing I want to say. Everybody says, well, look at the crime rates in the border cities. And they always use that. The left always uses that as an argument. Understand something. Their destination is not the border city. They're not interested in the border city. They come through, they get processed in a border city, and then they come to a city near you. We don't know the real crime statistic. There is no such thing as a real crime statistic, because we don't know. These people disappear into the cracks of society. And now with sanctuary cities, that doesn't help either. But I promise Americans this, if you ignore this crisis, if we don't build a wall, if we don't get new immigration laws soon and start enforcing the laws, we're going to have a serious problem in this country, because it's going to get ran over. It's like asking China, if all of China wanted to move here today, how many Americans, liberal or Republican, would say, oh yeah, bring them over?
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, we're being invaded.
Yeah. There's no two ways about it. It is without a doubt a crisis. It's a crisis for both sides. I mean, I spend a lot of time in Latin America, and I see the crisis from the other side.
Yep.
And I see these people being sold an idea by left-wing groups and governments and things down in Latin America, and even CNN. I mean, they have an infomercial that they run in Spanish that says, here is a list of cities that will welcome you with open arms in the United States.
Okay.
And it's like a 30-minute infomercial on how to come illegally to the U.S. and how to hide once you're here in these sanctuary cities. So I've seen it myself. I talked to these people, and I can tell you that it's a humanitarian crisis on their end, every bit as much as it is on our end. And I don't mean specifically that it's because they are, because they're living in poor conditions.
Right.
If it's just poor conditions, they could go to other places countries. In Latin America where things aren't as bad.
Yep.
And they could do just fine. But the reason that they're coming here is what the United States government needs to address.
Exactly.
You guys are doing.
And when they come through, just last note, most of my videos, if you watch them, they're dressed extremely nice, new tennis shoes. You'll look at their luggage is expensive. Mm-hmm. A lot of them come with a lot of cash in their pockets. We had a guy out here the other day, we opened his bag, he had over $10,000 in U.S. dollars in his bag.
Wow.
And now, thankfully, in that case, you're only allowed to bring $10,000. Mm-hmm. But my point is, a lot of them are just over here taking advantage, and it makes it tough, even from this standpoint, to tell the difference between the real ones and the ones that aren't.
Well, it's got to be tough for you guys, because you know the Border Patrol has to say, we don't need those guys, we don't have anything to do with them, but we know that you're helping out here. There's no way that you can't be, because what you're doing is you're getting the word out. And you know, that's what the Hot Zone podcast is all about. Whether or not if you're a liberal or a conservative, if you're left or right, it's hard to dispute the fact that we have a problem on this border. And whether or not you agree with what this Patriot group is doing, they are here on the border volunteering their time and resources to try to do something about the problem. And so if you're not down here doing something about the problem, I don't think you have much room to complain. But so I just say God bless you, and we'll be praying for you guys. And thank you very much for
what you're doing. Absolutely. Thanks.
The Hot Zone is produced by Amy Holton and Livefire Media. Copyright 2019.